responses back from people that we pray for as a congregation here. And I mean, I wish we would have started from day one keeping track of all the praise reports and the stories that we get back from people when we pray as a congregation for people. I mean, it happens weekly that we have people call or contact us through maybe you, some of you, or whatever, call the church or whatever, and ask for prayer for some reason because they know that they've heard of miracles and healings and things happen through. So just know that it's powerful when we pray for people. When we come together in unity and we speak the word of the Lord over somebody, the word of the Lord goes forth in their life. Amen?
Amen.
And it's powerful. Praise God.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This last Tuesday, we were praying about souls. We're praying for souls. And this morning, CJ just told me this morning through the internet, there were 7 people that contacted him and said that they responded to give their life to Christ this morning.
Amen.
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 Amen. Seven people gave their life to Jesus this morning on the live stream on the internet this morning. Amen. That's a good name. Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. For souls. It's harvest time. Amen. They're coming in. We're going to see more and more and more as the days get nearer. Praise God. Turn over to 2 Chronicles. Can you guys hear me okay on this microphone?
Yep.
It still doesn't sound loud to me for some reason. Okay. 2 Chronicles chapter 5. And I want to share something here that just to remind you guys, maybe some of you remember, some of you don't, but back in April, May 16th, the Lord spoke these words to me here, and they're gonna this word here is gonna go along with kind of what I'm gonna talk about tonight a little bit that's on my heart. But the word of the Lord came to me back in May on this May 16th of this year, and these are the words He said to me. He said, "Take ground and occupy," and then He said, "Advancement." And He's advancing His body. He's advancing His kingdom. Amen. And God reminded me of those words this morning as I was just kind of meditating on the word this morning before church. And I was meditating on unity, and I was meditating on the glory of God and how those two go together there. The glory of God and unity go together there. We can read several scriptures in the Bible where believers came together in unity, whether it was through worship and praise and singing and instruments, or whether it was through prayer, or whether it was through what we're doing right now, teaching of the Word or talking about the Word of the Lord. When they came together in unity, there was always a God would always come with His glory and manifest with His glory some way or another to bless the people that were assembled in that congregation or in that group of people that were there together. Amen? And not only did it bless them, but as it came upon them, or as they were in that glory, or in that the manifestation of however God was manifesting Himself during that time, they were able not only to be in that, but it came on them to where they were able to give that away as they left that meeting place. Does that make sense in our everyday lives? Amen? So see, when God does something to us, you know, you read the Word, I'm kind of getting ahead of myself here, but you read the Word, and it talks about Paul and Silas, and all them, they began to pray, and that place was shaken.
Yes.
They were filled with the Holy Ghost, and that place shook. Well, sometimes, even us, ourselves, we shake sometimes under that power and under that glory. Well, that is for us. God's blessing us with that. But see, He's wanting us to take that manifestation that we have personally, and He wants us to release that power. You might not see it. You might not even feel it come out of you. You might feel as dry can be. But there's still that anointing that's in you because you are the temple of the Holy Ghost.
Right.
Once you get born again and you ask Jesus to come in your life, the Holy Spirit automatically comes and lives on the inside of you. Praise God.
Amen.
And then, of course, it's another thing to be filled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, to pray in other tongues and all that. That's another step you take. But the Holy Spirit's there. He comes and lives on the inside of you. Praise God. So He spoke to me that day in May, and He said, "Mike, it's time to take ground and to occupy and to advance. I'm advancing my body. I'm advancing my kingdom. Take ground and occupy." Okay, well, the Lord said that to me, and I'm like, okay, Lord, well, what does that mean? And you can kind of get an understanding just hearing that, taking ground and occupy. You can see in your mind a picture of you taking over some ground and occupying it. Putting your house there, putting your stuff there, you're occupying this. Well, that's part of it, praise God. God will send you to a certain city or a certain church or a certain job or whatever. He'll send you to a certain group of people or something. And He wants us to occupy that. But what He really wants us to do is He wants the Holy Spirit that's on the inside of us to occupy that area. Now, I know that sounds kind of wild, but it's true. He wants us to release spiritually what He's put in us or what He wants to do through us in that area, that territory. He wants us, by the Holy Spirit, by the Spirit of God, to occupy that area. To occupy that ground. Now, see, I believe this. I believe when God told Joshua, I will give you everywhere your foot treads. When God has called you to a certain city, a certain place, maybe He's told you to go to a certain place just for a moment in time, just an hour or two in time, to go to a certain place, a certain ground, and to declare something or to pray something. He knows what He's doing, and He wants us to be led by the Holy Spirit so we can allow the Holy Spirit to flow out of us to take over whatever and do whatever He needs to do for that area, that situation.
Amen.
You know, here 2 summers ago, we went back to Missouri on a family vacation. We went back there and visited some relatives and hung out there for about 12 or 13 days or so. And while I was back there, or actually before I went, about a month before we went on this vacation, I was sitting there, and I came across this prophecy about Catherine Kuhlman, and which I enjoy Catherine Kuhlman and her ministry, the ministry she had and things like that. And so I was reading this little article, and I come across her birthplace there. Oh, it slipped my mind now. I had it. Concordia, Missouri. It's kind of there off the main highway there, almost about, I don't know, about an hour or so from Kansas City there. It's just this little town. And I come across this, and all of a sudden, as I read where she was from, I heard the Lord speak to me and say, go to her hometown. And I don't even know where Concordia, Missouri is at. I knew I was going to be in Kansas City and a few other places there in Missouri, but I had no idea where this was even at, if it was even going to be close to where I was at. So immediately I got on the old trusty phone.
Yep.
Where is Concordia, Missouri? And it showed me, and it was literally right down the highway that I was going to be driving right through.
Hallelujah.
I said, thank you, Lord, for making it easy for me. Praise the Lord. And so I'm like, okay, well, what do you want me to do in this hometown where she was born? And so I started kind of looking around on the internet to see what was going on. I knew the home was still there that she was born in and things like that and all that. And I come across, they have a monument of her in the town square, recognizing her as a minister of the gospel and moving in the gifts of the Spirit. It even says on this plaque, and gives her birth date and the date she passed and all this kind of stuff. And they have this big, huge plaque right in the middle of the town square there, right by all these American flags and next to the man that founded the city. I thought, wow, that's cool. So I go, that's where I'm going to go. That's where I felt like the Lord wanted me to go, right in the middle of town there in the town square. So I went to that and I pulled up into the parking lot. This is little just town square, middle of the day. And I just got out and I said, okay, Lord, well, I'm here and I'm going to go. I'm just going to go stand by that plaque and I'm just obeying what you told me to do. I don't know if there's going to be some kind of impartation or some kind of deal that you want to do in my life or whatever. But I'm here just obeying you. And I went and I did that. And I just stood there. And as I was standing there, my family was with me, the kids and Monica and stuff. And we were standing there. And I just said, Lord, we're here. If there's something you want to say to us or do in us, Lord, we're here. But we're just obeying you. And we thank you for the life that Catherine Kuhlman lived and the anointing that was on her, Lord. And I thank you that we could move in that anointing as well like she did, Lord.
Amen.
And that was it. I didn't feel goosebumps. I didn't fall out in the power. I didn't, you know, anything like that. It was just an obedience.
Yeah.
But see, there's certain territories, there's certain places, there's certain grounds that God will have us go to for certain reasons.
Yeah.
And I shared that story because there's certain places in this city.
Amen.
There's certain places maybe in this state, or maybe even in, I never thought I would, he would have me go do something like that in another state that I don't even live in, I've never lived in, just visited several times. Right. You know, I guess I could say I have some roots there because my grandfather and grandmother and my dad and relatives were born there or from there or whatever. I've never lived there. I've lived in California all my life, but for some reason, God wanted me to do that. See, now we've got to be led by the Spirit of God. He tells us to take ground. He told me to take ground and occupy. And he wasn't saying it just to me personally. He was saying it to the body of Christ that it's time we take ground and occupy. Now, I know. Since Dad got up here and he started talking, and it was like we were just kind of, I was following him what he was saying up here because I don't know, what's the word I'm looking for? I was tracking with you when you were up here because before you got up here, you started talking about the faithful ones, the ones that God has called, the ones that God has been faithful and didn't quit and didn't give up, but they kept pressing in and seeking God and following God. As he was talking about that, the Holy Spirit was talking to me about that before he got up here and started saying that. And I'm going to tell you, since probably around 2000, the year 2000 here, in this ministry, the Believer's Church of Madera, in this ministry, God, and maybe even before 2000, but I really feel like since around the 2000, is when God really started to raise up and deal with the people, and you might not even been here yet, but he started raising up and dealing with people to come into this ministry, to be a part of this ministry for the last days.
Amen.
Come on. And there were people here. See, back then the church was bigger than it is now.
Yeah.
Probably about 100 people, at least, give or take. And I've watched a lot of those people leave. A lot of the people that I thought were in it for the long haul, they left.
Yeah.
That I thought were sold out, solid, committed. Here we go. And they might have been for a moment of time, a period of time. But there was a lot of soul searching that's been going on since the year 2000 in this ministry. I've watched it. And it's funny, not funny, but it's kind of wild because I've gone back through prophecies that were given back in the 90s over this church. And a lot of the prophecies were there's a day coming when there's going to be a lot of soul searching and God is getting ready to thin out and almost rebuild about this ministry.
Yeah.
About the Believer's Church of Madera ministry.
Come on.
Church. And it's wild because I've watched God do that. And a lot of us in here, like I said, maybe some of us are newer. And there's not a big crowd here, but some of us are newer. Some of us have been here for a while. But I'll tell you what, since the year 2000, in my personal life, personally, there's been a whole lot of shaking going on. You know what I mean? There's been a whole lot of shifting. A whole lot of weird, wild stuff that's taken place. And what God is doing is he's wanting to shake out of us. Like Dad was talking about this morning, King David got on his face and said, God, search my heart. I don't want anything in me that's not of you, Lord. I want to follow you with all my heart to the best of my ability.
Yes.
Yes. And rely on you, lean on you, trust in you, follow you, Lord.
Yes.
So since the year 2000, I've seen a lot of shaking. I've seen a lot of things going. I knew there was people here even during that time. I was still kind of young in ministry. And I even knew by my spirit that there was people here. And I would talk to Dad and say, I don't think these people are going to last. I think they're going to leave, Dad. I can see God trying to get them, talk to them, gave them years, talk to them about certain things, just making a shift. Listen, folks, serving God, you've got to shift. You've got to, there's times where, no doubt about it, several times you're going to have to make adjustments. You're going to have to shift with the season. You're going to have to let go of certain things that maybe you've been doing for 15 years and walk away from those things because it's a new level you're going to. It's an advancement you're going to. Things are just going to have to walk out of that God don't want you in anymore to take you into other things that he wants you in.
Right.
So it's not just, oh, I'm a Christian, I'm along for the ride. There's a whole lot of shifting, turning, changing, ups, downs, forwards, back. There's all kinds of stuff going on while you follow Jesus.
Amen. Yeah.
But it's not a scary thing. It's not a bad thing. It's a good thing.
Yes.
You know, and Dad hit on it this morning about we got to know the Word of God.
Amen.
You know, and I believe the people here are people that are Word people. I mean, I know you are.
Yeah.
You know, You have a love for the Word. You want to know the Word because you know the Word works.
Yeah.
And the thing is this, is if we don't know the Word, listen, the Word is really our only weapon. That's our only weapon against the enemy is the Word of the Lord. And we need to stand. And I feel like I'm preaching to the choir tonight, but I know we're standing or you wouldn't even be here, but we've got to stand.
Amen.
We've got to take that stand. Ephesians, we've got to put on the whole armor of God and we've got to stand there for. And so I've watched since the year 2000, I've watched God wanting people to take ground. I've watched God wanting people to deal with things in our lives. Even myself, we've gone through processes. We've gone through situations. We've gone through circumstances. We've gone through valleys. We've been on the hill. We've gone through valleys. We've been on the hill. But the people that will stand and will not waver.
Yes.
There's people in here that have been close to death.
Yes.
And God raised them up and delivered them.
Hallelujah.
People in this building right now, there's people that go to this church that have been close to death, and God has healed them and raised them up.
Yes.
And put them into their promise.
Hallelujah.
Because they didn't quit.
That's right.
Because they didn't quit.
And he'll do it again.
He'll do it again. You got to get that mindset. That no matter what happens, if you follow God, he's going to take care of you no matter what happens.
Right.
He will heal you again if he has to. If you lose everything you have, he'll give you everything back that you need. That's the kind of God that we serve. And I think that's what a lot of Americans, including myself, are learning, that we've got to take our hands off trying to control everything and just let God do it as we follow him.
Amen.
All he wants us to do is obey him.
Amen.
That's it. I believe it's Isaiah 45 that I was talking about there. About he's known us since we were in our mother's womb. He'll take us, carry us, hold us until we get gray hair.
Amen.
Or no hair.
Yeah.
I don't plan on going that route. Praise God. But if I do, he'll still take care of me. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Take ground and occupy.
Amen.
Now, that word advancement here, the word advancement means the act of moving forward, the act or result of making something better or more successful. Now, here's my favorite definition. The act of being raised to a higher rank or position.
Amen.
Amen.
Folks, whether you believe it or not, you are being raised to a higher rank or position.
Yes.
In the body of Christ.
Yes.
And don't let that get to your head. Don't be big-headed about it.
Amen.
Stay humble. Stay before the face of God. Stay at the feet of Jesus. Stay humble about it. Stay in that mind of being a servant, not being served. Praise God.
Yeah.
Keep that mindset.
Yeah.
Stay humble about it and let God advance you. Because listen, if he gives you more power, it's not for you anyways. It's for others.
Amen.
If he blesses you with more anointing or a healing gift or some kind of gift of the Spirit or something like that, it's not for you, it's for them.
Amen.
It's for people. And the cool thing about it is when you operate in what God has called you to operate in, when you walk in what God has called you to walk in, you'll manifest the goodness of God and he will reward you because you diligently seek him. He will reward you because you have a heart after him. The Bible says that a man's heart that follows God, that's what that was saying earlier, a man's heart that follows God will abound in blessing.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's the word of the Lord, hallelujah.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's for every person that believes that
yeah,
and wants to function in that and walk in that truth and that reality of the word, hallelujah.
Yeah.
Amen, praise God. This is good teaching, man. Hallelujah.
Yeah,
God.
Yes,
right. I'm enjoying this myself, praise God. I'm learning it myself, hallelujah. The Holy Spirit knows what he's talking about. The Holy Spirit will make you look like a genius.
Yeah.
Amen. It's true, praise God. So, we're advancing. Isaiah 54, don't turn there, but Isaiah 54 verse 2 says, enlarge the place of your tent. When God is shifting you in your life, don't grind the gears. It doesn't say that in Scripture, but that's what I added. Isaiah 54, 2 does say, enlarge the place of your tent, enlarge your territory, as the Lord uses you and moves you and expands you. But as he's doing it, let him shift the gears. Don't grind those gears. Go with the program. Follow along with it. Even though maybe, oh man, you don't want to let go of certain things or whatever. And God's going, well, I want to move you into something else.
Right.
And in your mind, because listen, folks, we've all been there, I know it. In your mind, it doesn't make sense sometimes.
No.
You're like, I remember, can I use you for as an example, Linda?
Sure.
Good. I got the microphone now. No, I remember when, because Linda was working here at the church and doing our administrative part, and taking care of the books and doing the things like that. Just a tremendous help for years. How many years?
14
years. And I remember. And when was it when you left it? When you went to start the Doors of Hope? 2000. Like five.
I went over there in 2007.
Okay, I knew it was right around there. But I remember when she said that she was going to be leaving this her duty here at the church and doing that, and in my mind it didn't make any sense. I thought, no! Oh, we can't lose Linda, no! You know? I'm like, really, Lord? You want her to start a pregnancy care center, Lord? I'm like, wow, and it just didn't make sense. I thought, you know, oh man, and I wasn't like mad at her about it or anything like that, but I was just like, man, Lord, you know what? That's pretty wild. Are you sure, Lord? You really want Linda to do that, you know? But see, in my mind, it didn't make sense. And I don't know about Linda. I've never asked her, but in her mind, it was probably like, what? Really, Lord? You know? But God will ask us to do things sometimes that in our mind doesn't make sense. Or He'll want us to maybe let go of something, maybe temporarily, or maybe forever.
Yeah.
And it might not make sense to us.
Yeah.
But He knows. He said things to me that I'm just going, really, Lord? I mean, wow. How? And then all of a sudden your mind can tell you, how is that going to happen? How is that even possible, Lord? You know? But see, He tells us things. He shares things with us to prepare us ahead of time.
Amen.
He gives you dreams to prepare you ahead of time. He gives you visions to prepare for something for ahead of time.
Amen.
And if we'll just walk with Him, praise God, and not grind the gears when He's shifting us into things, that shift might be kind of painful for a while, and you might not understand what that shift totally is. But listen, He never tells us to fully understand everything all the time. He just wants us to go with Him.
Amen.
Amen?
That's right.
The disciples on that ship, Jesus said, get on the boat, we're going to the other side. They get on the ship, Jesus says, I'm tired, I've been preaching. I'm going to go lay down in the bottom of the boat, take a nap. I'll see you guys when we get on the other side. Wake me up. What happens? Storm comes, storm rises. The disciples freak out. They wake Jesus up. Jesus gets up, commands the storm to stop. The storm stops, and He gets back and goes back to sleep. But the disciples, well, Jesus said we're going to the other side, but the storm's brewing here, and we might not make it to the other side. It's uncomfortable sometimes. And I'm not making fun of the disciples because I've done that myself in areas of my life. Or I freaked and I'm just like, I don't know, man. And all this. But they did the right thing. They went to Jesus.
Amen.
Now, even though they could have taken authority over that storm, they just weren't there yet.
Yeah.
Sometimes we're just not there yet. We've got to be discipled. We've got to learn.
Yep.
We've got to get understanding. See, we've got to get understanding on who we are as a believer, who we are in Christ. We've got to get an understanding of the Christ in Christ principles. We've got to get an understanding of the blood of Christ. We've got to get an understanding of the authority that God's given us on this earth over devils.
Yes.
Yeah.
And over darkness.
That's right.
And over disease. See, disease and sickness comes from the devil.
Yeah.
Comes from hell. God don't give nobody sickness. Amen? I don't want nothing that's not. I only want what's from heaven. I don't want anything that's not from heaven.
Amen.
In my life. Amen. So that's why Dad said this morning, and man, when he said this, I wanted to jump up and preach and tag team off of what he said here. But he said, we got to know the word.
Yes. Hallelujah.
That just keeps coming back in me, out of me tonight. But we've got to know the word of God, man, for the season that we're in. Amen. Amen. So take ground and occupy, body of Christ. It's time for advancement. We're moving forward into a higher rank or a position. We are all individuals in the body of Christ We're all members of the body of Christ. We're one in the Spirit. We're one in the blood through the blood of Jesus Christ as the body of Christ. But we're also individuals in the body of Christ, being that finger, being that toe, being that arm, being that foot, whatever. We have our part to play as individuals, but we're all one in the Spirit. Listen, folks, there's so much power when it comes. There's so much power in unity when we pray in the Spirit. Now, I want to say it to where I make sense when I say this. There is something, listen, God will use us even if we're not in the same building. God will use us in the Spirit as individuals, but He'll link us up as the body even when we're not in the same building, and we can even be praying about the same thing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Praying in the Spirit, being led by the Holy Spirit, is the most powerful thing on the earth that you can do as a believer.
Yeah.
I've heard of stories of where one person's in Wisconsin, one person's in Hawaii, and some other person's in another state, and come to find out around the same time or during that same day, they were praying exactly for the same thing in the Spirit.
Hallelujah.
Here's an example that happened real life in my life that I experienced. Back in January 2008, the Friday that they knew something was really wrong with my body and really wrong with my blood, and they did a bone marrow test on me that day. Well, that night, when they did that, Mom called Pastor Tom in Wisconsin. She called Sister Norma here at our church. And she called Tony Mary Kroger in Missouri. That afternoon, she said, there's something wrong with Mike. The doctors are really, really concerned. We need you to pray. They prayed. And we all got reports back within 24 hours. And all three of those different people in different states said the exact same three words to tell me. They said, tell Mike, God told me to tell him, all is well. All three of them.
Glory.
When I heard that, that settled it. And you know how awesome God is? He'll still bring more words as that process goes, just to beef you up even more. It's like taking spiritual steroids, man. You know the devil ain't going to do nothing about it anymore because of the word of the Lord. Now, I had to take my stand. I had to believe those words. I had to grab onto those words for dear life, literally, and believe that word, and stand on that word, and speak that word, and declare that word, and sing that word, and pray that word, and walk that word. I mean, everything I could do to do the word, I was doing it. You can ask my wife, you can ask my family. And some of you were around here during that time and you saw it. Now, I'm not sharing this to think I'm really cool and super Christian. I'm just sharing it because we gotta know the word. But three different people in three different states, the Holy Spirit said to them the same three exact words to tell me. Now come on, that isn't a coincidence. That's the word of the Lord. That's how our God is. He cares about us. And He wants to give us something that we can hold on to and fight. Every time the devil's mouths off to us, we just mouth off back to him what the Bible said about it. What God said about it. David didn't let Goliath punk him out, make him run and hide in the hills. David knew who his God was because he spent time with him out there shepherding those sheep. He sang to him. There's something about praise. There's something about worship. There's something about getting over into the Spirit and worshiping the Lord God. It does something to you on the inside.
Amen.
He knew by the Spirit of God, and he knew the covenant that he had with his Father, Father God, that no devil in hell was going to keep him or his people out of their land.
Right.
And he didn't walk up to Goliath and say, No. He walked up and said, you are going to die today.
Yes. Right.
I'm going to feed your carcass to the birds of the air today.
Amen.
Because you're an uncircumcised Philistine. You do not have a covenant with God. And I have a God that's going to destroy you. And we know the story.
Yeah.
He knew who he was in God. Why? Because he spent time with us. You start to feel shame. You start to feel depression. You start to feel anxiety, fear. You start to feel all this stuff from the enemy come on you. Immediately step over into the praise realm.
Hallelujah.
I'm teaching myself. I'm training myself how to do that.
Amen.
Because we're all human beings, and we all wake up some mornings, and we don't feel good. We don't feel like it. We don't want to, you know, oh, we're tired of it or whatever. All this stuff tries to come on us. But I'm learning now to enter over into that praise room. Enter over into that praise realm with the Father.
Yes,
and it don't take much anymore to get right up into that. And it's like, okay, here we go. Let's go, man. Praise God.
Glory.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So we're taking ground. There's so much power in the Spirit. Now look over here. You thought I forgot about 2 Chronicles. I didn't. 2 Chronicles chapter 5. Look at, let's look here at verse 12, start with verse 12. Now this is the dedication of Solomon's temple here, okay? And it says here in verse 12, and the Levites who were singers, all those of, I don't know these words. I can't even pronounce, I don't even know how to say that. Huh?
Asaph.
Heman. And Heman. And Jeduthun with their sons and their brethren. Thank you for not naming me any of those names, Mom and Dad. Holy moly. Poor guys. I'll meet them someday, but man. Okay, with their sons and their brethren stood at the east end of the altar, clothed in white linen, having cymbals, stringed instruments, and harps, and with them 120 priests sounding with trumpets.
All right.
Can you imagine that? 120. Okay, so I want you to see this here. You see these guys, there's 120 trumpeters, plus there's people that sing, plus there's people with stringed instruments standing here in this temple. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Okay, now look. Verse 13, indeed, it came to pass when the trumpeters and singers were as what?
One.
Not as they were individuals, but were as one to make one sound to be heard in praising and thanksgiving the Lord.
Amen.
And when they lifted up their voice with the trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music, and praise the Lord, saying, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever.
Hallelujah.
That the house of the Lord, the temple of Solomon, was filled with a cloud.
Praise God.
That cloud is the Lord. Yes. That cloud is the manifestation of the glory of God.
Yes.
Is what that is.
Yes.
And it says, so that the priest, verse 14, that the priest could not continue ministering because of the glory or the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the house of God.
Yes, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Now we see this portion of scripture here. It's talking about Solomon's temple. It's actually talking about a temple, kind of like a building that we're in right now. It was a building.
Yes.
Okay, that's the old covenant. We get into the new covenant now where the Holy Spirit has been put in us, praise God, after the death of Jesus and the resurrection of Jesus. We become the new temple. The Bible calls us that our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God doesn't reside in that Solomon's temple anymore.
That's right.
He resides in us.
Yes.
After Jesus died, that veil was ripped. They say that sheet was 4 feet, was it 4 feet thick? Or four, what was it, four? Something like that.
I don't remember, to be honest.
It was really, really thick, though.
Yeah,
really, really thick. They said that thing tore in half. Who tore that thing in half? The hand of God. Why did he do that? Because he wanted to say, no more do you have to go into,
that's right,
behind the veil.
That's right.
But now he's in you. You can come before me.
Yes.
Man to man, you can come before me into my presence because the Holy Ghost lives on the inside of you. You see this here. Now I know that to me, praise and worship is praise and worship. Now let me clarify that. I can have the worst voice on the face of the earth and still praise God with it.
Yes. Amen.
He's still going to come on me. He's still going to come into the room. He's still going to heal. He's going to manifest. He's going to do what he needs to do.
Right.
You don't have to go to music school and get a degree to be a praise and worship.
Yeah.
Worship.
Yeah.
Listen, we can have instruments. We can stand. We can sing a cappella. We can stand up here and sing the same song 20 minutes in a row. And if our heart is worshiping the Lord, he's going to come into the place.
Amen.
Are you getting the picture?
Yes.
People want to make it some big deal. It is a big deal, but it's a heart deal.
Amen.
And it makes it even more powerful when it's a unity deal.
Amen.
When it's a one deal.
Yes.
And it makes it even better when you have the instruments.
Yes.
Like we just read there.
Yeah.
Why do churches believe that you shouldn't have instruments? Just read the Bible.
Amen.
It's right there. It's good to worship the Lord on the piano. Amen. It's good to worship the Lord with the trumpet. It's good to worship the Lord with every kind of instrument. As long as you're playing before the Lord.
Yes.
That's the key.
Amen.
But I want you to see how important that is. That God just does not dwell. And see, a lot of people, the people in America think that you got to go to church to get God. You got to go to a building to receive something. Now, listen. We can gather out on the first 5 acres of my grandpa's property out of his house in the dirt and in the weeds.
I know. Yeah.
In the pasture. We can gather out there next Sunday morning. And you know what? God will fall there too. Because we're all one. The Holy Spirit lives on the inside of us. It's not in a temple anymore. We're the temple of the Holy Ghost. And that scripture is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Let's read that actually. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Look at verse 19 and 20. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Verses 19 and 20. And what's wild about these scriptures here is verse 18. His dad even hit on verse 18 a little bit this morning. Should I read verse 18? About sexual immorality. And what it does to the inside of your body. It's how huge. Look at verse 19. Do you not know that your body is the temple? The very sanctuary. I'm reading out the Amplified. The very sanctuary of the Holy Spirit who lives within you, whom you have received as a gift from God. You are not your own. You were bought with a price, purchased with a preciousness, and paid for, made His own. So then honor God and bring glory to Him in your body. Now listen, don't let this scripture get you over into some kind of condemnation. Oh, God, man, I've defiled my body. I've done bad things. Look, we all have. We've all made mistakes. But that's why the blood's there in forgiveness. Amen. We need to get into all that. We understand that.
Amen.
But our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. He's in us. And He wants us to stir Him up. The Bible tells us to stir up the gift, to stir up the Holy Spirit by praying in the Holy Ghost. The Bible tells us to stir Him up. He's in us. Now, there's something about that oneness. There's something about that unity there. Listen, I feel like I'm in unity with my brothers and sisters, especially the people that are here at this ministry, the ones that have committed here, the ones that I know God has called here, and they've put their feet in the ground and said, this is my fellowship, this is my company, this is the local church God has called me to be at. There's a oneness here, and I feel one in the Spirit with them, or with you guys, or with those people, when I'm not even here.
Yes.
I feel that spirit of unity. I feel that. There's a oneness there. It's like you know that you have people that are protecting you and have your back in prayer because you're one with them in the Spirit.
Amen.
Because they've said yes to the vision that has been preached from this pulpit. And they've said yes to this. And they're tracking not only with us as the pastors, but they're tracking with the leadership in the church to where we're here for one reason, and that is to show the love of God to Madera, California.
Amen.
And wherever else He wants to send us outside of these walls, in this region, or wherever. And I'm telling you that there's a oneness there, there's a spirit there, there's a power there, there's a manifestation of God. It's amazing to me that when we get together on Tuesday morning in our prayer time, it's amazing to me that we usually end up talking for a half hour, 45 minutes before we start to get into prayer. And it's amazing to me to hear the people share and how they're tracking in the Spirit during that week, what God's been showing them and talking to them. It's all along the same lines almost every time when they share. It's amazing how the Holy Spirit will do that. See, so when we're not here, and when we're doing the work of the Lord, when we're praying in the Holy Ghost, when we're praying, when we're spending time with the Lord, when we're getting the Word of God, we're not only doing that for ourselves. It does edify us. It does build us. It does strengthen our faith. It does strengthen our hearts in the Lord. It does do that. But it's also doing way more than that. It's going out beyond our little walls that we're sitting in there, and it's going out into the Spirit, and the Spirit of God and the angels of the Lord that are working with Father God are moving in the areas that God is having us pray out in the Spirit. Amen? You hear what I'm saying tonight? Praise the Lord. That's the truth. Listen, don't think of yourself as, I'm this little Christian over here in Madera, California. I just have this little fellowship that I go to, and I have my little, you know, sphere of friends that are believers, and we have a good time and fellowship with them. We're one in the Spirit and all that. You're more than that.
Amen.
And some people online that are watching tonight, whatever city, state you're in, you're more than that. God wants you to affect that whole region in prayer.
Yes.
I've heard Christians say this, well, I just don't feel like I'm called to the prayer ministry. You're called to the prayer ministry.
That's right.
You're the house of prayer. That's what you are. And so, I know there's a lot to this, and there is some good teaching, and we can get into some of this kind of stuff, but listen, all it amounts to is us, which I believe that the people that are sitting in this building tonight are doing this. So this must be for other people. I don't know, amen. But anyways, just kidding. I believe that it simply is just us yielding to the Father God on a daily basis.
Yes.
Just yielding to Him. It's not a works thing. It's not, you know, this. It's just saying, Father, I'm open to You today. Use my mouth. Speak to me. Show me what You want me to say. If You want me to go somewhere. I just want to be submitted and yielded to You today by Your Spirit, Lord. I guarantee you, and I can't, and maybe God will reveal this to us someday when we get to heaven or something. But I guarantee you, there's been probably thousands of times we've said things on a daily basis that we didn't even know were affecting something in the spirit realm. Or convicting somebody, or saving someone's life that we don't even know got born again because we've never seen them again, all because God uses us to say one thing to them. We got to think about that. Because guys, our tongues are powerful. And when you're in tune with the Spirit, and you want to follow God, and you want to do the will of God for your life, He is going to get His will through you one way or another. I bet you there's times that there's sometimes that maybe we don't even recognize that He's using us and He's using us.
Yes.
That's how amazing He is. That's how much He cares for that other person or even for you. Hallelujah. There's oneness in the Spirit. There's oneness in unity. There's oneness in God. And He has said to us, listen, I know all of us in here right now, there is a ground that we are occupying right now. And maybe if you haven't ever thought of it that way or heard it that way, then maybe just ask the Lord, Lord, what ground is it that You want me to occupy in the Spirit, Lord?
Yes.
I could be living in my home on my street, and that's where my family lives, that's where I occupy, that's my piece of ground, that's my home, that's my property. But he might want me to also occupy in the spirit another piece of ground here in town.
Right.
In the spirit.
Right.
He might want me to go to that place and stand and pray. That's how Oral Roberts built Oral Roberts University there.
Amen.
He started praying over that land. God started talking to him about it. He started declaring it. Same thing with Brother Hagin with Rainbow Bible School there. Same thing. God wanted him to occupy that ground.
Yes.
He said yes. He began to pray into it, believe the word of the Lord, pray over it. God ended up doing it. Now those two pieces of ground, I've been on both of them over the years. A few times. Several times. And those two pieces of ground right there are affecting thousands upon thousands upon thousands of lives coming from those two pieces of ground. Still today in the world. All over the world. Because they took it and they occupied it. They took it first spiritually. Come on. That's a good word, man. I thank you, Lord, for that. I need to hear that. Revelation to me. They took it spiritually first. When God shows you, you take it spiritually first. Then, when you take it spiritually first, then he'll begin to develop to where it'll be naturally in the natural and doing spiritual things. Praise God. You know, when mom and dad moved up here in 1983, you know, I was 9 years old, so I really didn't understand why we were coming up here. I just knew that I was leaving, you know, the school I was at, the friends I had down there, and I was moving up here to a new town. I had knew nothing about Madera. I didn't like it at first, you know, because it was all new and this and that. It was weird. I didn't like it. And I lived out in the country at first, and I didn't want to live out in the country because I didn't like, you know, whatever. Everything was new to me. And I didn't understand. I just knew that they were starting a church here. And that God told them to come do that. And that's all I really knew. But as time went on, I realized that God gave them this ground in the Spirit. Now he wanted them to occupy it.
Right.
And they've occupied it ever since then because God's never told them to go do anything else.
Yeah.
He might have you on a piece of ground for a long, 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 long time.
Yeah.
He might have you at your job you're at right now, or your business you're at, or something you started, your business, whatever. He might have you at that ground because he wants you to occupy that ground for the rest of your life, maybe. I don't know. Or he wants you to occupy that ground for a season.
Yeah.
You know, just to talk about my best friend Bonner here for a second. God has had him occupy all kinds of high school stadiums up and down this valley. Because he knew he was assigned by the Lord to do that. And he got a hold of that. And as he was in those stadiums, at one point or another, he would release whatever the Lord wanted him to release in that stadium spiritually.
Amen.
See, not many folks know that. Hardly anybody. A lot of people know it now. I hope he doesn't mind. I don't think he does. Because it's a God thing anyways. And again, it's God. But he said certain things in those stadiums led by the Holy Spirit to say, so the fruit will produce. And no telling how many other people in that town or in that city God has used over in those stadiums to say the same thing he said. He doesn't even know it. Because revival is hitting in Central California, San Joaquin Valley, state of California. And those stadiums are going to be used. You're going to start hearing about football stadiums.
Yes.
And I'm not saying it's all because of Coach Cunnings. A big part of it is because of Coach Cunnings, but it's because God is using people to take that ground and occupy it in the Spirit. Bonner don't live in that city. He doesn't live in that stadium. He doesn't even live across the street from the stadium. But his feet were there and he occupied it in the Spirit by releasing out of the Spirit of God on what he wanted to say over that stadium.
That's right.
Over that high school, that area. Yeah. Think about it that way, because that's the truth. That is the truth. That's why we need to be really sensitive in these days we're living in here of what we're saying, good or bad, about certain things, certain people groups, certain places in our cities. Look, you know, I've been guilty of that. I'm getting sick and tired of looking at downtown Madera. It's disgusting looking. Why can't we have it look nice like Visalia, or even downtown Pursell, or even downtown Chowchilla?
Come on.
Come on, Chowchilla.
Oh, wait, there's an opening here. I can't hide behind the pool. But God's been talking to me about that. Stop complaining and start blessing. Just last week, I walked over here and I was frustrated about something. I'm not going to tell you what it was because it's gross, but I was frustrated about something. I said, I'm getting tired of being in this building. Why can't God give us a building somewhere else? Steve knows what I'm talking about. Cleaning the patios of this church. I'm cleaning them now. Helping them out a little bit. And I'm like, why can't God give us a piece of ground? We can have some grass, you know, a place to hang out, have people come. We can have barbecues and just relax and fellowship, have some room, you know. And I'm just right on this tangent, using my mouth. And then when I finally shut up, God's all, are you done yet? Shut up, basically is what he said. And I knew what he was talking about. I said, you're right, Lord, you're right. I shouldn't be saying stuff like that, Lord. Forgive me for those words. I bless this place. I bless this town. I bless this area, Lord. Yeah. You know, and then you get out of your little selfish crybaby thing, and then you get back over in the spirit, and you realize that you need to do what's right. You know what I mean? Yeah. So we got to use our mouth in the spirit to speak into things. Speak over our families. Praise God. Speak that they're coming in. Speak that the glory of God will visit them.
Yeah.
Speak that the peace of God will just engulf their home and their families. Yeah. And continue to speak. Even when it doesn't look like, even when it looks like maybe things are going the opposite direction that you're saying, continue to speak the word of God. The word of God never, 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 never fails. Never. It's established forever. It will never change. Yes. The goodness of our God will never change. His love for his people, his love for people will never change. He'll always love. Even the ones that go to hell for eternity, he'll love. He'll still love them. He loves us. He loves your town. He loves where you're at. He loves you. He loves who's around you. And I'm telling you, man, that we have taken ground and we are occupying in the Spirit. Continue, guys. I just want to encourage you to continue to operate in the Spirit. Continue to operate in the Spirit of God. Continue to be a speaking spirit.
Yes.
Like the Lord calls you. Continue to speak over your region. Continue to speak over your life, your family, your finances, your job, the plan that God has for your life. Keep your ears tuned, your spiritual ear tuned to what God has called you to do. Praise the Lord, man. Thank you, Father. God will inhabit the praises of his people.
Yes.
He will literally, his glory will literally come down from heaven and manifest when you praise and when you worship him. That's how real that is. We might not see it. We might not feel it. We might not even fully understand it. But I know the word. I understand the word. And I believe the word that when we praise and worship the Lord, he inhabits the praises of his people.
Absolutely.
That's why I know coming into this service, coming into these services here with you guys on a weekly basis, I know that we're going to get together and worship God, and I know God's going to show up. I know he's going to show up. How he shows up, I don't know, but I know he's going to show up and bless people and help people and minister to us. Well, it's the same thing at your home. He inhabits the praises of his people. Start letting the glory loose in your home by praising him. Hallelujah, why not? That's who we are. We want to be close to him. We want him to manifest.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, I've preached myself happy tonight. Praise God.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a lot more that you can really like expand on and pound on and things like that here in this chapter, chapter 5 here. But you should stay in his presence. Stay open to hear what he is saying to you. Not only about you, but about the area that you're in. Let him speak to you about it. Let him use you. Amen?
Yes.
Thank you.
Amen. Hallelujah. Dad, do you have something to add on to that? How many of you? You always do. Which is a good thing.
Amen.
Not always. 99.9% of the time. So not always.
You know, he was talking about taking ground. Let the Holy Spirit show you the ground. you know, you might seek the Lord in this area, and he might start showing you the school system, or a high school, or he might show you your neighbor's house.
Yeah.
He might show you something in another state.
Right.
He'll show it to you.
Yeah.
You know, the Bible says that the prophet Habakkuk, he said, I will stand upon my watch, I'll sit upon my tower, and I will see what the Lord will say to me.
Yeah.
God wants to show us. See, he's got this whole thing networked.
Yes.
Billions of Christians, yes, networked nationwide.
Yes, amen.
I remember back in the 70s, early 80s, we were in Clovis still, and Karen was praying one day, and she, I believe you were praying, and it sounded like a Mideastern type
language. Yeah, my tongue changed.
Yeah, she was praying in the spirit, like Mike was talking, and then she began to see Muslim men lift up as they were in prayer. They lifted their faces up and they saw Jesus, right? That was before any of this Muslim terrorism or any of the stuff that's, you know, the way our world has shifted now was going on. Mm-hmm. And there is a tremendous revival among Muslims right now in the Middle East.
Jesus is appearing.
Yeah, Jesus is appearing. Many, there are people going into Pakistan, not just Todd Bentley, and other people, having thousands of people get saved. And so things are happening.
We'll hear about that in a second.
But those things don't just happen. They happen because somebody went there ahead of time and took the ground in the spirit.
Yes. Yes.
In intercession.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Father Nash, who used to go ahead of
Charles Finney,
he would, if they were going to be having a crusade in a certain city, he would go ahead of him, days ahead of him, and he would lock himself up in a room and begin to pray and intercede for that city. And he would groan and he would travail as the Spirit of God would come on. God, you know, God told him to do that. God gave him that assignment. And even Finney himself, he said he would go out and pray. And he said, I'd find myself saying things that shocked me. He said, I would hear myself by the Spirit saying, God, you don't think we're not going to have a move of God here, do you? You don't think we're going to not have a revival here, do you? In other words, it was like this thing that came on people, and they possessed in the spirit that ground in that place.
Yes.
And as that happened, then the God could come in and he could move mightily.
Yes.
So we need to be those kind of people.
Yes.
You know, being willing to go ahead and to step into a place in the spirit. Mm-hmm. God will show you.
Yes.
He'll show you. Yes. He may have you praying for people in China or a place in China. He knows what he's doing. Amen?
Amen.
And that's, you know, about praying the Holy Spirit, how he'll direct your words. I remember one time I was, you know, the Bible talks about the word of the Lord. You know, there's like a two-edged sword coming out of your mouth, you know, and the word of the Lord is your sword. And I remember one time it was in 2008, I was driving down to my doctor's to have an appointment. And I was driving and I was praying in the Holy Ghost, and I started saying the word kendo, over and over and over again. I had no idea what it was. And then I realized, after I got done praying, after a while, I realized that it was like some kind of, is it Chinese or is it Japanese? Japanese word. I knew it had to do something with some kind of dialect like that. And I called Mark. And I asked him, I said, I know that word means something. It has to do with martial arts or something, I think, or something like that. I've heard the word before. And he said, it's a type of sword fighting. And when he said that, as soon as he said that, I put two and two together. I knew by my spirit why the Lord had me saying that, because he wanted me to use my mouth like a sword, because the word of the Lord is like a sword.
Sword of the Spirit.
A sword of the Spirit. And I held on to that, and I'll never forget that, because it was like the Lord was showing me, keep using my word in the spirit as a sword. Keep speaking over your body, whatever, you know, that leukemia that was in your body, keep speaking over it. And I'm cutting it out by the sword because the word of the Lord, you know. And so see, he'll do those things in our lives. He'll have us speak out by the Spirit, and then he'll give us revelation on what we're saying. Praise God.
Yes, yes, yes.
It's cool how he doesn't do that all the time to me, but it's cool when he does it. Amen. So there's a reason for it. I'm sure it's happened to you before too, but listen, we're not quitters.
Amen.
We're the Green Berets, man.
Amen.
God's called us.
Amen.
You know, I was talking with Grandma Pat this afternoon on the phone, and she wasn't feeling well, so that's why she wasn't here today. But I was talking with her on the phone this afternoon, and she said, isn't it awesome that we have people at our church that just stick their feet in the ground and they pray?
Oh,
and
yeah.
They pray. And they pray until God moves, until something moves, something shifts, yeah. something happens. Isn't it awesome?
Yeah.
I said, yes, I'm glad I go to a church with people that are like that. Praise
yes.
God.
Yes.
It's powerful. Amen.
Amen.
Is there something online?
Actually, Grandma Pat, she's watching right now. I had a conversation with her earlier. She said she's been healed.
She's been healed. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hi, Grandma Pat. We love you. Thanks for watching tonight. You're famous now. I just spoke to you over thousands of people over the internet watching you, Grandma Pat. Glad you're here, Grandma Pat. Amen. Amen. Praise God. We'll stand up. Hallelujah. Praise God. God's good, isn't he? Loving Father, he's got divine appointments for you this week. He's got people that he wants you to touch, to love on, to serve, to bless, to help, to pray for. He's got them for you. Be led by the Spirit of God and just let the Holy Spirit speak through your mouth. Even if you don't have the answer, you don't know what to say, just let the Holy Ghost talk through you. He will. He'll talk to those people and help them. Amen? Lord, we thank you for this time in your word tonight. Lord, we love you so much. And Lord, we thank you that the healing is manifested in Grandma Pat's body, Lord. Hallelujah. We thank you for that, Lord. And Lord, I thank you for everyone in this place tonight, Lord. I thank you that you've called us for great things on this earth, God. And Lord, we just want to say that we love you. And we thank you that you have a great and mighty purpose for everyone in this building, everyone that's in your kingdom, Father God. You have a great and mighty work for the army of God, the kingdom of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And Lord, we say tonight that we will do and we will walk with you and we will fulfill the will, the plan, and the purpose that you have for our lives, Lord. Our hearts are after you. We thank you that you direct our steps, Father God. We thank you that you lead us this week into divine appointments, Lord. Use us, Father God, to heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out devils, Lord. Use us to speak the word of the Lord by love. Hallelujah. Let people see Jesus in us. Hallelujah. And we thank you, Father, that your Spirit lives on the inside of us. And we are anointed to do what you've called us to do on this earth, Father. We trust you. We honor you. And we thank you for everything that you've said to us today. You've done in our lives today. We give you all the honor and the praise, Jesus Christ. We love you tonight. In Jesus' name. Amen.